Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents African Americans in the Revolutionary War by Lieutenant Colonel Retired Michael Lee Lanning. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. Author to audience. Theoretically, history is first and foremost the chronological record of significant events. In practice, however, the gathering of dates and places is the least complex process of capturing the past. The difficulty in writing history is not the when and where, but the what and why. Complicating any effort to record events and their significance accurately and fairly is the fact that, along with inherent problems of locating sources and information, each historian brings his or her own agenda to a project. Rarely is history unfettered by the beliefs, feelings, values, and self-interest of the historian. Ultimately, and all too often, history becomes a record not of what actually happened, but the historian's interpretation of those events. Military history, in particular, offers classic examples of how written accounts reflect not so much the reality of wars and armed conflicts as the perspective of the historian assimilating and analyzing the events. To the victor go not only the spoils of war, but also the recorded version of the conflict. A predictable sequence of literature appears. Personal narratives are usually the first books published about a campaign or war. These works provide a valuable but narrow view, covering only the extremely small field of vision of the individual. Unit or ship histories are generally the next accounts to find their way into print, and these works focus almost exclusively on the loyalty, bravery, and dedication of the unit's soldiers or ship crews. The official histories appear soon afterward, written by victors, to whom victory alone stands as the justification for the war and its outcome. Histories by the defeated, if written at all, appear long after the fact as apologetic and remorseful renditions of the facts. After hostilities conclude, and for hundreds of years thereafter, academicians move in to pick the bones of decisions, actions, and accounts. They harvest the battlefield to assemble their versions of the conflict, which then becomes history. Unfortunately, many of these learned individuals record and interpret military operations without the insight of personal experience in uniform. Their results then reflect their personal agendas as much as their research. Nowhere are these factors and influences more evident than in what passes for the black history of the Revolutionary Era. Footnote. Only the histories about the Vietnam War come close in their unrelenting, blatant biases to those of the Revolutionary War. End of footnote. More than 5,000 black men joined the rebel Americans in the war as soldiers, sailors, and marines. Many more supported the rebellion as laborers. Their service went largely unrecognized and unrecorded. Few letters, journals, or other narratives of black individuals about the revolution exist because whites had denied most African Americans an education. White historians of the period, and for years after the war, ignored the contributions and impact of thousands of black participants for several reasons. First of all, prejudices were so deeply ingrained that it did not even occur to most whites of the time that black Americans had played a significant role either as individuals who fought or labored, or as a segment of the population that affected decisions. Prejudices also prevented some who did witness the contributions of African Americans from honestly reporting that black soldiers could perform equally with whites on the battlefield if given the opportunity. Others did not mention black soldiers because of the difficulty of explaining why the United States kept 500,000 men, women, and children enslaved while fighting for independence and liberty. Any study of the American Revolution, particularly in respect to participation by black Americans, faces obstacles in every aspect of the research process. Most writings on the war simply exclude or greatly downplay African American participation. Historians who do include accounts of black involvement in the revolution tend to exaggerate their contributions and at times repeat unverified or unfounded stories. The predetermined agendas concerning black Americans, either positive or negative, of nearly all writers on the American Revolution clearly show through their narratives. Regardless of their veracity, existing publications contain, in one form or another, most of the information known about the revolution and its participants. Little additional information is likely to be discovered. Even if an obscure diary or collection of letters surfaces, its impact will be small. The most extensive information source on the American Revolution is the cataloged, published, and minutely scrutinized collected papers of George Washington. Military records on file in the archives of the original 13 states provide other important resources. National records are few because many of the federal government files of the Revolutionary period burned in a fire at the Washington, D.C. storage facility in 1800. The British destroyed other period documents when they occupied the capital in 1814. As a result of sparse record keeping of the time and the destruction of documents since, it is not possible to compile a complete listing of participants or even those who died in the American Revolution. The best estimate is that 300,000 rebel American soldiers and sailors served during the war and that 4,000 to 7,000 died in battle. Another 18,000 died of disease and from other non-combatant causes. Unfortunately, these estimates are suspect. Available documents rarely mention race, making any estimate of African American participants and casualties in the Revolution all the more difficult. The following chapters are the result of the careful study of each piece of the puzzle, the fitting together of scattered fragments of information and material deemed reliable to fill the glaring holes. A brief look at the major publications on black participation in the Revolutionary War demonstrates the difficulties of research. For more than 50 years after the war concluded, published histories ignored the efforts of black Americans in the conflict. In 1855, William C. Nell, a free black native of Boston, published the first detailed history of African Americans. Nell included in his Colored Patriots of the American Revolution a chapter on each state's black military and civilian participants. Nell's work, often described as more enthusiastic than scholarly because of his personal agenda to promote his race, includes many individual profiles and accounts that otherwise would have been lost forever. Harriet Beecher Stowe provides the best summary of Nell's book in its introduction, where she states, "The colored race have been generally considered by their enemies, and sometimes by their friends, as deficient in energy and courage. Their virtues have been supposed to be principally negative ones. This little collection of interesting incidents, made by a colored man, will redeem the character of the race from this misconception and show how much injustice there may often be in a generally admitted idea." The next two publications about African-American participation in the Revolution were a direct result of the Civil War. Both books provided official documents and letters relating the history and accomplishments of black Americans in the Revolution, but their real purpose was to promote the emancipation of slaves and their enlistment as soldiers and sailors to help preserve the Union. George H. Moore, the librarian of the New York Historical Society, published Historical Notes on the Employment of Negroes in the American Army of the Revolution in 1862. George Livermore, a member of the Massachusetts Historical Society, produced the much more detailed and historical research respecting the opinions of the founders of the Republic on Negroes as slaves, as citizens, and as soldiers the following year. After the Civil War, the only significant work in the latter part of the 1800s was The Black Phalanx, a history of the Negro soldiers of the United States in the wars 1775 to 1812, 1861 to 65, written in 1890 by Joseph T. Wilson, a black Civil War veteran of the 54th Massachusetts Volunteers. Although not as detailed as Livermore's writings on the Revolution, Wilson's better understanding of soldiers and the army is evident. From the latter years of the 19th century until the mid-20th, African-American periodicals, such as the Negro History Bulletin and the Journal of Negro History, became the primary sources for publishing additional information on black participation in the Revolution. The beginnings of the civil rights movement of the 1950s and the approach of the Civil War centennial produced greater interest in black history and influenced the award of academic grants to fund extensive research. articles began to appear in scholarly university and state historical commission journals. In 1962, the University of North Carolina Press published for the Institute of Early American History and Culture the most detailed work to date. Benjamin Quarles, supported by multiple grants, including a John S. Guggenheim Foundation fellowship and a leave of absence from the faculty of Morgan State College, became the esteemed expert on the subject as a result of The Negro in the American Revolution. Despite his propensity to include every bit of information he discovered in his decade of research, his lack of military experience, and his efforts to placate his funding sources, agendas that occasionally show through, Quarles' book is magnificent. The opening sentence of his preface has become the most quoted single sentence on Black involvement in the rebellion. In the Revolutionary War, the American Negro was a participant and a symbol. Sidney Kaplan, who was an emeritus professor of English and Afro-American Studies at the University of Massachusetts, and Emma Nogrity Kaplan, former reference librarian at Smith College, added the wonderfully illustrated The Black Presence in the Era of the American Revolution. The Kaplans include a section on Black military participation, but their major contribution is in telling the story of African-American businessmen, clergymen, artists, and other contributors to arts and commerce of the period. Today, African-Americans serve in every specialty and at every rank in the U.S. Armed Forces. The story of their long struggle for opportunity and equality, much of which began during the Revolution, has not always been told well, if at all. The author's hope is that the following chapters will give credit where it is due and fill in missing information about African-American contributions to the Revolutionary War previously left blank. 1. African-American Heroes of the Revolution. It was early on the evening of April 18, 1775, when Paul Revere and William Dawes spotted the two lanterns hung in the steeple of Boston's North Church. In response to this prearranged signal, the two men spurred their horses and rode into the night to warn American rebels. "The British are coming! The British are coming!" shouted the riders as they raced from village to farm. At the alarm, local militiamen rose from their beds and mansions, small houses and slave quarters to secure their weapons and assemble with their units. The British were indeed advancing north from Boston toward the villages of Lexington and Concord with six companies of light infantry totaling nearly 400 men. Their orders from General Thomas Gage were simple. Having received intelligence that a quantity of ammunition, provisions, artillery, tents, and small arms have been collected at Concord for the avowed purpose of raising and supporting a rebellion against His Majesty, you will march the Corps of Grenadiers and Light Infantry, under your command, with the utmost expedition and secrecy to Concord, where you will seize and destroy all military stores whatever. Revere's and Dawes's warnings provided the local Minutemen time to prepare for the British advance. By morning, Lexington Militia Company Commander Captain John Parker stood with about 75 men in a staggered line across the 2-acre common located in the center of the village. The captain's orders to his company typified the feelings of many of the colonists. "Stand your ground, don't fire unless fired upon, but if they mean to have a war, let it begin here." Footnote. As with many other famous quotes and stories from the American Revolution, the accuracy of Parker's words is difficult to verify. As glorious and patriotic as they may sound, they did not appear in print until 1858 and were credited to the recollection of Parker's grandson. End of footnote. Parker and his militiamen, tired of British taxation and oppression, were determined to defend their village and their perceptions of freedom and liberty. The irony, of course, was that neither Parker nor any of the other white participants appear to have appreciated the fact that their ranks contained several men to whom freedom would not apply. The very patriots who professed the desire for liberty for all did not mean literally all. In the small company, several armed African Americans stood alongside their owners, prepared to secure a freedom hitherto denied their race. Footnote. As noted earlier, Enlistment documents and unit rosters, if they exist at all, seldom recorded the race of participants in the American Revolution, making it difficult to determine the exact numbers and origins of those who fought. End of footnote. The ragtag white and black militia company made little impression on the more experienced, much larger British force. Even the first gunfire of the Revolution, the famous shot heard round the world, initiated by an unidentified source, failed to convince the British that the Americans were serious. The British commander, Major John Pitcairn, merely ordered a volley of fire over the heads of the Lexington militia. He then demanded the surrender of weapons. When Parker apparently instructed his men to comply, some laid down their muskets while others began to walk away. But then more shots rang out, again their source unidentified, and Pitcairn ordered another volley, this time into the dispersing ranks of the Lexington militiamen. In a matter of a few minutes, 9 American soldiers lay dead, and another 8 were injured. The casualty list itself is telling of the war effort by all participating Americans, for among the wounded was Prince Esterbrook, a Negro man, according to the roster of participants and casualties on Lexington Green that appeared in the Salem, Massachusetts, Gazette of April 21, 1775. Another mention of him, in the journals of the Provincial Congress of Massachusetts, also noted the African American's participation in the battle, describing him as Prince, a Negro. Later, broadsides also listed the veterans of Lexington Green. An undated one, probably published a few days after the battle and currently on file at the Massachusetts Historical Society, includes the name Princey Esterbrooks, a Negro man, among the casualties at Lexington. Footnote: Revolutionary War documents often include different spellings of the same name. End of footnote. As the British marched from Lexington toward Concord, they encountered more colonial militia units. Again, these ranks contained black members as well as white, for African Americans, both free and slave, assembled with their fellow minutemen to fend off the British. Among those black Americans taking part in the ensuing battle were Peter Salem and Samuel Craft of Newton, Cato Boardman of Cambridge, Cuff Whittenmore and Cato Wood of Arlington, and Pomp Blackman, hometown unknown. While Prince Esterbrook had been among the first to shed blood for American independence at Lexington, another black person, unidentified, suffered one of the last wounds of the war's initial day. When blocked by the rebels at Concord Bridge, the British retreated. As they retraced their steps, militiamen pursued, adopting the Native American tactic of firing at the withdrawing force from behind trees, fences, and impromptu fortifications. Just outside Boston, at Charlestown Neck, according to the journal of a British lieutenant in the Royal Welsh Fusiliers, a Negro was wounded near the houses close to the neck, out of which the rebels fired to the last. Although African Americans were among the earliest casualties of the Revolutionary War, Esterbrook and his fellow black militiamen were not the first to shed their blood for American independence from Great Britain. 5 years earlier, Crispus Attucks, an escaped slave-turned-sailor, played a major role in the first confrontation between the rebellious colonists and the British military. In 1770, Americans were chafing under increasing taxes and harsh military occupation by the British Crown. The citizens of Boston particularly disliked the oppression and arrogance of the local British Army garrison, and the long, cold winter did little to cool their tempers. Early in the evening of March 5th, Crispus Attucks joined several of his fellow sailors as they warmed themselves around a public house fire while they awaited their ship to sail from Boston Harbor. Much of their talk focused on the unfair treatment they received at the hands of the British and their animosity toward the redcoat sailors. Attucks participated little in white men's conversation, but he shared their feelings of injustice, perhaps even more so, for the black sailor had escaped slavery to go to sea more than 20 years earlier. Suddenly, the group sharing the fire became aware of excited voices in the street, followed by the ringing of the town's alarm bell. Attucks raced to the door to discover the snow-covered street filled with men moving toward the British headquarters on King Street. Some of the men seemed to be agitating the crowd, while others attempted to stop the mob's progress. A few began to flee. Attucks stopped a young man leaving the scene and asked what was causing the commotion. The youth explained that a British soldier had refused to pay after receiving a haircut and then beat the barber when he demanded his money. Other colonists came to the support of the barber as more soldiers appeared and threatened to shoot if the mob did not disperse. The colonists made a few more verbal retorts at the men in uniform and reluctantly began to drift away. Laughing at the verbal threats, the soldiers marched back to their custom house barracks. Several accounts of eyewitnesses describe what happened next. Although the stories vary somewhat, all agree that a short, stout, curly-haired black man pushed forward and urged the hesitant crowd to stand up against the soldiers. With the leader now in charge, the colonists followed Attucks to the custom house, where they threw snowballs and rocks at the buildings and its guards. The frightened sentinels called for reinforcements. Attucks picked up a heavy piece of firewood and shook the club at the soldiers as he dared them to fire. The swelling mob behind him surged even closer to the custom house. Despite the missiles hurled by the crowd and the threats of the club-wielding Attucks, the disciplined British soldiers adhered to their instructions to fire only upon the orders of their officers. British Captain Thomas Preston arrived and ensured that his men held their fire as he unsuccessfully attempted to convince the mob to disperse. His efforts only made the Bostonians angrier. Attucks, along with a dozen other men, advanced still closer, and the escaped slave began striking a soldier's bayonet with his wooden stick. He then swung his club at Preston's head. As the officer countered with his arm to ward off the blow, he bumped into one of his soldiers, causing the man to drop his weapon. Instantly, Attucks seized the musket. The soldier also grabbed for the gun, and the two struggled for control. In wresting the musket from the black man, the soldier stumbled and fell into the icy slush. The colonists laughed and, now confident that the soldier would not shoot, began to chant, "Why don't you fire? Why don't you fire?" Attucks, leaning on his stick, mockingly stared at the wet, muddy redcoat. Humiliated, the British soldier regained his feet and fired directly into Attucks's chest. Instantly, the other soldier shot into the crowd. Attucks and five others lay dead or dying in the street. Despite his color, the colonists hailed the dead Attucks as a hero and the first casualty of what would become the American Revolution. Few acknowledged, however, that Attucks, an escaped slave, would not have been able to share the freedoms for which he sacrificed his life. Attucks would not be the last black man to die for a country and a cause that did not recognize him as an equal or ensure that he turned from the liberty for which he fought. The Boston Massacre, as it became known, fanned the flames of revolution that, in turn, led to open warfare at Lexington and Concord. 2 months after those skirmishes, the war's first major battle took place. Once again, the action occurred in Boston, and as in every fight that followed, black Americans were in the forefront. After the Battle of Concord Bridge, the British withdrew to Boston. During the following weeks, the colonial militias united to surround the port city. In June 1775, as they tightened their cordon around Boston, the rebel commanders decided to send a force to occupy Bunker Hill on the narrow peninsula at the end of Charlestown Neck, at the city's edge. Upon arrival, the American commander discovered that adjacent Breed's Hill offered more defendable ground and established his force there. History would record the upcoming battle as Bunker Hill, but in actuality it was on Breed's Hill that the Patriots and their opponents' blood would soak the ground. In the militia ranks on Breed's Hill were at least a dozen African Americans, including several veterans of the earlier skirmishes. On June 17th, the British attacked in waves from the beach. The dug-in Americans waited, as ordered by Colonel William Prescott, until they could see the whites of their eyes and initially slowed the attacking redcoats. Black and white Americans stood together to resist the assault, but ultimately a shortage of ammunition and the superior numbers of the British finally forced the rebels to retreat. One of the last to withdraw was Cuff Whittemore of Captain Benjamin Locke's Arlington, Massachusetts Militia Company. According to Samuel Swett, the earliest historian of the battle, in his Notes to His Sketch of Bunker Hill Battle, published in 1825, Whittemore fought bravely in the redoubt. He had a ball through his hat, and he fought to the last, and when compelled to retreat, though wounded, he seized the sword of a dead British officer. Footnote. That white officers allowed a black private to keep, and later sell, a captured officer's sword is substantial evidence of the respect his superiors had for Whittemore and his performance in the battle. End of footnote. Another black soldier achieved even more fame for his valor at the Battle of Bunker Hill. Peter Salem, claiming as his last name the town near his Farmington, Massachusetts birthplace, was born in about 1750 to a slave held by Jeremiah Belknap. Peter grew into a tall young man of great physical strength and vigor. Sold shortly before the Revolution began to Major Lawson Buckminster, Peter Salem joined his owner's militia regiment and saw his first military action at Concord Bridge on April 19, 1775. Still enslaved, Salem enlisted a few weeks later in the 1st Massachusetts Regiment, commanded by Colonel Thomas Nixon, and on June 17th stood in the trenches on Bunker Hill with his fellow white and black soldiers. Varying accounts exist of Salem's performance in the battle, but all agree as to his courage under fire. At the center of all the stories is the fate of British Royal Marine Major John Pitcairn. Major Pitcairn, a veteran of the battles of Lexington Green and Concord Bridge, anticipated the battle with relish. Shortly before the fight, the major stopped in a Boston tavern for a glass of brandy. As he spun his finger in the glass, he boasted, "I will thus stir the Yankee blood before night." After the initial volleys of rebel fire from Bunker Hill into the advancing British, Pitcairn and his fellow officers rallied their troops for repeated assaults. As the British line closed on the rebel trenches, Pitcairn shouted, "The day is ours!" Amid the hail of gunfire and smoke, Salem took careful aim at the British officer and calmly shot him through the chest. The mortally wounded Pitcairn fell into the arms of his son, a Marine lieutenant in his father's regiment. Several of the battle's witnesses noted Salem's actions in their diaries or later writings. Jeremiah Belknap, Salem's original owner, wrote in his diary in 1787 that a Bunker Hill veteran told him, "A Negro man took aim at Major Pitcairn as he was rallying the dispersed British troops and shot him through the head." An eyewitness report, referenced in a letter by Aaron White of Thompson, Connecticut, provides what appears to be the most accurate account. According to White, the eyewitness told him in 1807, "The British Major Pitcairn had passed the storm of our fire and had mounted the redoubt, when waving his sword, he commanded in a loud voice the rebels to surrender. His sudden appearance and his commanding air at first startled the men immediately below him. They neither answered or fired, probably not being exactly certain what was to be done. At this critical moment, a Negro soldier stepped forward and, aiming his musket at the major's bosom, blew him through." Salem's officers later introduced him to General George Washington as the man who shot Pitcairn. More acclaim for the performances of Salem and other black men at Bunker Hill resulted from a painting by John Trumbull, who witnessed the battle from Roxbury across the harbor. 11 years after the battle, Trumbull unveiled The Battle of Bunker Hill, which prominently shows a black servant handing a Connecticut officer a musket in the midst of the fight. At the center top of the painting is another black soldier. Trumbull's work, hailed as a classic of realistic military history paintings, today hangs in the U.S. Capitol Rotunda in Washington, D.C. Engravings of the painting appeared on private notes issued by Boston and other banks. The painting increased the awareness that black Americans played a significant role in America's struggle for independence, but some writers have misidentified the prominent servant at the right of the painting as Salem. Actually, the much smaller image of a black soldier at the top of the painting is more likely the heroic slayer of Major Pitcairn. While official accounts of the actions by individual soldiers, white or black, during the Revolution are extremely rare, still another African American performed so well at Bunker Hill that his actions, too, made written history. Salem Poor, a 28-year-old freeman from Andover, Massachusetts, enlisted in Captain Benjamin Ames's militia company shortly before the battle. 6 months after the fight, 14 officers petitioned the General Court of the Continental Congress to bestow upon Poor the reward due to so great and distinguished a character. The document, signed by all 14 officers, proclaimed, "The subscribers beg leave to report to your honorable house, which we do in justice the character of so brave a man, that under our own observation, we declare that a Negro man called Salem Poor of Colonel Fry's regiment, Captain Ames's company, in the Battle of Charlestown, Neck, behaved like an experienced officer, as well as an excellent soldier. To set forth particulars of conduct would be tedious. We would only beg leave to say in the person of this said Negro centers a brave and gallant soldier." The bloody encounter at Charlestown Neck's Bunker Hill convinced both the British and the rebellious colonists that the war for American independence would not be short. Neither the British nor the Americans, however, possessed united fronts in support of the war, nor were they decisive about how to conduct their campaigns. Great Britain, although a world power, faced possible threats on the European continent from France, Spain, and Holland. Simultaneously, some of its political and military leaders empathized with America's desire for independence and stalled support for efforts to put down the rebel lion. One-third of the American population supported the rebellion. Another third, known as Tories or Loyalists, remained loyal to the crown. Still, another third were indifferent. Throughout the long war, which did not conclude until 1783, the capabilities and zeal of both the British and the Americans varied from time to time and battle to battle. The British, distracted by worldwide military commitments to an empire on which the sun never set, did not have the energy, money, or military assets to devote to defeating the rebels. Although they committed about 42,000 regular troops and reinforced them with 30,000 German mercenaries, the British never marshaled their entire resources against the American rebels. On the other hand, the Continental Army never fielded a force larger than 30,000 men, and often the number dropped to only 20,000. On occasion, the Americans had as few as 5,000 men in their army. As a result, except for the war's initial battles, the smaller, weaker American armed forces made little effort to conduct sustained combat or lengthy campaigns. The colonists had to avoid defeat, hoping they could attain victory through survival. Manpower was a critical issue for the rebel colonists. The white population numbered only 2 million, fewer than 700,000 of whom supported the rebellion. About 500,000 African Americans, mostly slaves, also resided in the 13 colonies at the beginning of the war. These black Americans, both slaves and free, had served in local militias since colonization began, especially in the North, defending their villages against attacks by Native Americans. Despite their military service prior to the rebellion and their brave actions in the war's opening battles, the sheer number of black people frightened many white Americans who remained reluctant to accept black men in uniform in any capacity. At the same time as the Battle of Bunker Hill raged on at Charlestown Neck, the Continental Congress assumed jurisdiction of the state militias and formed the Continental Army, with General George Washington as commander-in-chief. Washington, a slaveholder himself, recognized that regional differences among the colonists complicated his problems in organizing, leading, and maintaining a unified force. An initial issue that threatened the stability of the new Continental Army was the concern that Southern states had about arming black Americans. Many Southerners feared a slave rebellion more than a British military. One of Washington's first actions as commander of the Continental Army was to placate the Southerners as well as others who shared their fear about African-American enlistments. On July 9, 1775, Washington had his adjutant general issue an order to recruiters not to enlist any deserter from the ministerial British Army, nor any stroller, Negro, or vagabond. Over the next several months, Washington issued additional orders excluding black Americans from serving in the military. Eventually, however, severe manpower shortages and the fear that black Americans would join the British Army forced him to sanction the enlistment of African Americans. In the interim, though, mounting casualties, desertions, and completion of enlistments encouraged many subordinate commanders to ignore the orders and enlist men regardless of their color. As a result, black soldiers stood in the ranks of practically every infantry company and worked on the decks of each warship, serving as scouts, guides, couriers, spies, wagoners, cooks, orderlies, and seamen from the war's first shots to final victory. Black participants did more than simply fill slots in military units. They displayed enormous courage and individual bravery. Beginning at Lexington, Concord, and Bunker Hill, heroics were common among the more than 5,000 African-American soldiers and sailors who contributed to America's independence. William Billy Flora, a freeman from Portsmouth who served in Colonel William Woodford's 2nd Virginia Regiment, typified their efforts. At the Battle of Great Bridge, near Norfolk, Virginia, on December 9, 1775, Flora so impressed his officers that after the battle, Captain Thomas Nash wrote, "Flora, a colored man, was the last sentinel that came into the breastwork. He did not leave his post until he had fired several times. Billy had to cross a plank to get to the breastwork and had fairly passed over it when he was seen to turn back and deliberately take up the plank after him amidst a shower of musket balls." Despite having only a third of the white population in support of the rebellion, the Continental Congress confirmed its Declaration of Independence on July 2, 1776, and 2 days later proclaimed the document to the world. Written by Thomas Jefferson of Virginia, the document began, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." One truth, immediately self-evident, was that the Declaration's promise of liberty did not extend to more than 500,000 African Americans held in bondage. Jefferson, a slaveholder himself, nevertheless harbored objections against the practice and included in early drafts of the document a clause that would have ended slavery. However, South Carolina and Georgia raised objections so strenuously that they created a threat to the union of the North and South. Jefferson struck the clause from the final document and sealed the fate of black Americans for another century. Despite being denied liberty by their country's formal Declaration of Independence, African Americans still volunteered to endure the hardships and dangers of combat to guarantee the freedom of the United States. Some did so in response to promises of release from slavery in exchange for their service. Others either willingly or unwillingly accompany their owners into the military as servants. Still others volunteer to leave the monotony of their current life for the prospect of adventure afforded by military campaigns. All believed that their race as a whole could only benefit from their demonstrated loyal service. The British response to the Declaration of Independence was an increase in military pressure to quash the rebellion. Washington's army suffered defeats on Long Island and at New York in August and September 1776, and by December the rebels were in full retreat southward through New Jersey and into Pennsylvania. The fervor of revolt cooled with the losses and the approaching winter. In a report to the Crown, a British commander described the American army in the winter of 1776 as almost naked, dying of cold, without blankets, and very ill supplied with provisions. Enlistments faltered, and the future of the United States appeared bleak. Washington knew he had to improve the morale of his army and the American public. The only way to do this dramatically was to ignore the 18th century warfare tradition of spending the winter months in encampments. Instead of focusing on the cold, Washington procured every serviceable rowboat and barge available and assembled a force of 2,400 men along the southern bank of the Delaware River. Early on the evening of December 25, 1776, Washington addressed his men as they prepared for a Christmas attack against the Hessian garrison across the river in Trenton, New Jersey. The general quoted lines from Common Sense by Thomas Paine. "The summer soldier and sunshine patriot will in this crisis shrink from the service of their country, and he that stands now deserves the love and thanks of man and woman. Up and help us, lay your shoulder to the wheel. The heart that feels not now is dead. Those who stood that day and lay their shoulders against the wheel with Washington on the snowy field included scores of African Americans, both free and slave. For 23-year-old Freeman Oliver Cromwell of Burlington County, New Jersey, a member of Colonel Israel Streve's 2nd New Jersey Regiment, the crossing of the Delaware and the Battle of Trenton would be only a small portion of the combat he would see during his nearly 7 years of Revolutionary War service. Another black soldier served in close proximity to Washington for the entire campaign, so close, in fact, that he appears in many of the paintings of the pre-battle preparations and as a rower in the general's boat during the actual crossing of the Delaware. This African-American was Prince Whipple, a man with an unusual story. Information about Whipple is scarce. The most detailed source is a brief description by William C. Nell that appeared in his groundbreaking book, The Colored Patriots of the American Revolution, first published in 1855. Nell acknowledges that the black soldier in the paintings of Washington is Whipple and further explains, Prince Whipple was born in Amabu, Africa, of comparatively wealthy parents. When about 10 years of age, he was sent by them, in company with a cousin, to America to be educated. An elder brother had returned 4 years before, and his parents were anxious that their other child should receive the same benefits. The captain who brought the two boys over proved a treacherous villain and carried them to Baltimore, where he exposed them for sale, and they were both purchased by Portsmouth men, Prince falling to General Whipple. Prince accompanied his owner, William Whipple, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, into the army at the beginning of the Revolution and served as the general's bodyguard and personal servant. At Trenton, General Whipple acted as a member of Washington's staff, and Prince fought alongside both officers for the entire campaign. Footnote. Several other accounts mention Prince Whipple's origins. At least one discounts the story of Whipple's being sent to America for an education and states that he was captured in Africa by slave traders and exported to the colonies in bondage. All of the stories agree that he did eventually become the property of William Whipple and that Prince accompanied him throughout the war. End of footnote. Whipple was not without black companionship while serving with the American commander's staff. Washington had purchased a young slave in 1768 named William Lee. Lee accompanied the general to Massachusetts when he assumed command of the Continental Army and served for the duration of the Revolution as Washington's personal orderly. Shortly after the war ended, Lee, still enslaved, asked Washington if he could bring his wife, Margaret Thomas, a free woman from Philadelphia, to live with him at Mount Vernon. Washington agreed, stating, I cannot refuse this request, as he has lived with me so long and followed my fortunes through the war with fidelity. Washington's crossing of the Delaware and victory at Trenton produced the morale-building result the general had hoped for, though it had little strategic significance. The British, occupying the major cities and ports, still possessed a far superior armed force. With the arrival of the spring of 1777, the Redcoats, not surprisingly, resumed their campaign to crush the American rebellion. Americans, black and white, continued their resistance and by the summer were fighting under a red, white, and blue flag composed of stars and stripes. It was adopted by the Continental Congress on June 14th. At Brandywine Creek, near Philadelphia, black soldiers once again proved their bravery. One of the stories of their service in the battle is probably more legend than fact, but nevertheless shows the impression the black warriors made on their fellow soldiers. According to accounts related throughout the states at the time and immortalized in a poem written a century later by Paul Lawrence Dunbar, a slave named Black Samson played a major role in the battle. Enraged by the battle death of a white soldier whom he considered a friend, Samson picked up a hay scythe and swept through the British ranks. Dunbar poetically described the action. Flee from the scythe of the reaper. Flee while the moment is thine. None may safely withstand him. Black Samson of Brandywine. Footnote. Some accounts identify the white friend as a schoolteacher who had taught Samson and whose daughter had provided him food. None of the rosters of the units that fought at Brandywine, however, list anyone named Samson, and no details other than the oral legends support the story. End of footnote. While Black Samson's actions at Brandywine on September 2, 1777 are without substantiation, the bravery and sacrifice of other African-American infantrymen in the fight are factual. According to the pension records of the state of Pennsylvania, John Francis, identified as a Negro in the 3rd Pennsylvania Regiment, had both legs much shattered by grapeshot at the Battle of Brandywine. Most Black soldiers in the Continental Army at Brandywine and other battles served in the infantry, but a few rode with the cavalry, while others manned the guns of the rebel artillery batteries. An obituary published in the January 15, 1834 edition of the Norristown, Pennsylvania Free Press provides details on the service of Edward Hector, who enlisted in Captain Hercules Courtney's battery of the 3rd Pennsylvania Artillery on March 10, 1777. Hector's obituary states, "During the War of the Revolution, his conduct on one memorable occasion exhibited an example of patriotism and bravery which deserves to be recorded. At the Battle of Brandywine, he had charge of an ammunition wagon attached to Colonel Thomas Proctor's regiment, and when the American army was obliged to retreat, an order was given by the proper officers to those having charge of the wagons to abandon them to the enemy and save themselves by flight. The heroic reply of the deceased uttered in the true spirit of the revolution, 'The enemy shall not have my team. I will save my horses and myself.' He instantly started on his way, and as he proceeded, amid the confusion of the surrounding scene, he calmly gathered up a few strands of arms which had been left on the field by the retreating soldiers, and safely retired with his wagon, team, and all in the face of the victorious foe." However, individual valor by Black or white patriots at Brandywine and the following battles in the fall of 1777 failed to stop the advancing British. In September, the Continental Congress hastily abandoned Philadelphia and moved to Lancaster and then on to York. On October 4th, the Redcoats occupied Philadelphia, and shortly thereafter, Washington and his army settled into winter quarters at Valley Forge. Washington later wrote about the long, harsh winter, stating that his army of about 12,000 was composed of men oftentimes half-starved, always in rags, without pay, and experiencing every species of distress which human nature is capable of undergoing. Samuel Poor, hero of the Battle of Bunker Hill, was one of the survivors of Valley Forge. Another Black soldier, Philip Field, a private in the 2nd New York Regiment, joined the more than 2,500 men who died of the cold and disease during the long winter. Despite their hardships, Washington's army emerged from Valley Forge rededicated to seeking their country's independence. Reinforced by units that wintered at other locations, Washington led an army of 15,000 against the British at Monmouth Courthouse, New Jersey, on June 28, 1778. Unit reports note that more than 700, or about 5%, of the rebel soldiers in the fight were Black. More important, 2 months later, after many of the white veterans of the battle had finished their enlistments and had been discharged, the number of Black soldiers in Washington's army remained the same. The American army managed to survive and therefore ensure the continuation of the United States during the summer campaigns of 1778. The approach of winter, however, once again found the struggling army occupying austere quarters at Valley Forge. Recruits for the rebel army remained a primary concern of Washington and his staff, and while the Continental Congress continued to call upon the individual states for additional battalions, the pool of available and willing manpower continued to diminish. More and more freemen and slaves, particularly in the northern states, enlisted in integrated units, but many remained relegated to laborer and support roles. Necessity, however, soon provided additional opportunities for African-American soldiers. Rhode Island, with a small population and two-thirds of its land occupied by the British, experienced extreme difficulty in providing sufficient numbers of able men for its two active duty battalions. At Valley Forge in November 1777, General James Varnum proposed that the two diminished battalions be combined into one and that the officers return to Rhode Island to recruit an all-black battalion. General Washington and Rhode Island Governor Nicholas Cook conferred and agreed there was no other way for the state to meet its draft quota. The concurring Rhode Island Assembly passed a measure authorizing the battalion and granting payments to owners of slaves who volunteered for service. With no reference to the need that necessitated the legislation, the Assembly nobly declared, "History affords us frequent precedents of the wisest, freest, and bravest nations having liberated their slaves and enlisted them as soldiers to fight in defense of their country." Colonel Christopher Green and other white officers organized black volunteers into five companies assigned to the 1st Rhode Island Regiment. Shortly after their formation and before completing training, the battalion rushed to counter a British Hessian offensive in August 1778 in what became known as the Battle of Rhode Island to control the state's major seaport. African Americans now had the opportunity to show their skills and bravery as a unit rather than only as individuals. In the four-hour fight that followed, the black Rhode Islanders held a critical portion of the Continental Line and suffered 22 casualties. As the war continued into 1779, the British altered their strategy of concentrating their efforts on the northern states and refocused their efforts to the south. Washington maintained his army in the north while dispatching his ablest general, Nathaniel Greene, to command the American army in the southern states. Even though they now fought on two fronts, the rebels retained their strategy of defense. They avoided sustained combat to maintain their country's survival as well as their own. On December 29, 1778, Savannah, Georgia fell to the British, who then used the port to mount offensives into the interior. The concerned Continental Congress adopted a resolution on March 29, 1779, recommending that the states of South Carolina and Georgia, if they think the same expedient, to take measures immediately for raising 3,000 able-bodied Negroes, that every Negro shall well and faithfully serve as a soldier to the end of the present war, and shall then return his arms, be emancipated, and receive $50. White manpower in the southern states was even more sparse than in the north, but slaveholders did not think it expedient to arm their slaves. In South Carolina, the ratio of black residents to white ones was 6-4. In Georgia, nearly 4.5-5.5. For slaveholders in these states, putting muskets into the hands of such numbers was tantamount to inviting insurrection. Additionally, these whites, believing themselves superior, were contemptuous of the idea of equality and freedom for their slaves. Furthermore, they did not wish to risk the loss or injury of their valuable property. Neither South Carolina nor Georgia enlisted black soldiers, but several African Americans made their way into the ranks as substitutes for their owners. Some slaves, like Austin Dabney of Burke County, Georgia, were freed by their owners in order to fill their enlistment obligation. Dabney served as an artilleryman in Colonel Elijah Clark's corps until suffering a musket ball through the thigh at the Battle of Kettle Hill, Georgia, on February 4, 1779. The Georgia legislature later honored Dabney for his bravery and fortitude and declared that no soldier was braver or did better in service during the revolutionary struggle. Other slaves who served in their owners' places did not necessarily gain their freedom. In 1781, white North Carolinian William Kitchen deserted his Continental Army regiment. When caught, Kitchen agreed to purchase Edward Griffin and deliver him as a substitute. Kitchen also agreed to provide Griffin his freedom upon his completion of honorable service. Griffin joined his North Carolina regiment in June 1781 and participated in several of the war's final battles. Upon his discharge in July 1782, Kitchen seized Griffin and, instead of granting him the promised freedom, sold him to a neighbor. Griffin remained a slave until he successfully petitioned the General Assembly of North Carolina on April 4, 1784. Along with the petition, Griffin submitted his discharge papers, which declared him a good and faithful soldier, and an affidavit from a witness who observed Kitchen's verbal promise of freedom for his substitute. The Assembly responded by declaring Griffin a freeman. In addition to their important roles in the Continental Army, African Americans also fought for the independence of the United States with Allied forces. France allied itself with the Americans against Great Britain in 1778 and supported the rebellion with ground and sea forces. Spain also declared war against Great Britain in 1779, adding to the list of British opponents on the continent and in the New World. In 1779, a French brigade of more than 3,500 men joined the American efforts in Georgia to retake the port of Savannah from its British occupiers. Within this French army were nearly 600 black freemen and slaves recruited in the West Indies and commanded by Viscount François de Fontaige. The joint American-French offensive against Savannah failed, but the black soldiers performed well nevertheless. The official accounts of the battle dispatched to Paris commended the black soldiers, stating, "The Legion saved the army at Savannah by bravely covering the retreat." Several of the soldiers in France's Black Legion in Georgia returned home to lead their own revolution and gain independence for their island nation of Haiti. Henri Christophe, a 12-year-old black infantryman wounded at Savannah, became the leader of the Haitian government. In Spanish Louisiana, Governor Bernardo de Galvez also employed black soldiers to defend his territory from the British. Accounts vary on the number of black soldiers in Galvez's force, 10 to 50%, with 15 to 20% the most likely to be accurate. Whatever their numbers, black soldiers performed well. Galvez's army pushed the British out of Louisiana at Baton Rouge in 1779 and then continued their offensive, capturing Mobile in 1780 and Pensacola in 1781. Galvez attributed much of his success to his black soldiers, declaring that his companies of Negro and free mulattoes had conducted themselves with as much valor and generosity as the white. The collective black service and the bravery of individual African Americans in the Revolution extended beyond land combat to service at sea. Black sailors played a heroic role in the U.S. naval battles and other seaborne operations during the war. Service at sea in the 18th century on fishing and commercial vessels or warships proved extremely difficult and dangerous. Experienced in the difficulties of finding and keeping crews, captains paid little attention to a man's color if he volunteered to sign aboard. In addition to freemen who sought sea duty, some runaway slaves, like Crispus Attucks, went to sea as a means of escape. Still other African Americans found themselves delivered to ship captains by their owners, who received their pay. Black sailors fought in every major sea battle of the Revolution, including as a part of John Paul Jones's crew aboard the Bonhomme Richard in its epic battle against the Serapis on September 23, 1779. Most of their service and sacrifice went unrecognized except for the notation on a crew manifest of a sailor being black, Negro, or mulatto. Most available information on black service at sea in the American Revolution comes from personal accounts written by ship captains and the various petitions filed by veterans in the post-war years. James Barron, commander of the Virginia state ship Liberty, recorded in his post-war memoir his recollections of the courageous patriots who had served on board his ship during the conflict. Barron concluded, "Amongst these, I take pleasure in stating there were several colored men who, I think, in justice to their merits, should not be forgotten. Harry, a slave belonging to Captain John Cooper, was distinguished for his zeal and daring. Cupid, a slave for Mr. William Ballard, stood forth on all occasions as the champion of liberty and discharged all his duties with a fidelity that made him a favorite of all the officers." The Continental and State Navies also welcomed black men as pilots for their vessels when navigating near the shore and on the inland waterways, and when maneuvering ships into ports. As one rebel naval official explained, black Americans were accustomed to the navigation of the river from their pre-war experience. One of these black pilots, Caesar, property of the Tarrant family of Hampton, Virginia, stood at the wheel of the schooner Patriot in several major actions, including when the ship captured the British brig Fanny. Black freemen performed with equal distinction. James Fortin, the third generation of a free family from Philadelphia, volunteered for naval service at the age of only 15. As a powder boy, Fortin joined 20 other black Americans who made up 10% of the crew of Stephen Decatur's 22-gun privateer Royal Lewis. In July 1781, Fortin participated in his ship's successful attack against the British brig Active. Unfortunately, their next engagement against three British warships was not as successful. When their captain surrendered, Fortin and the other black sailors faced sail in the West Indies by their British captors. The young Fortin became a favorite of the British captain, however, and the officer offered to send him to England to be educated. Fortin refused, saying, "I am here as a prisoner for the liberties of my country." While the U.S. Marine Corps would not officially accept African Americans until World War II, more than 150 years after the American War of Independence, a few black men did serve as Marines on land and aboard ships during the Revolution. 13 veterans are identified on the Marine Corps rolls as black, with three in the Continental Marines and the others spread across the detachments assigned to the state navies of Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Pennsylvania. At least one black Marine died in action aboard the brig Reprisal in 1777. Black soldiers, sailors, and Marines fought tenaciously for the liberty of the United States. Black freemen saw the fight for independence from Great Britain compatible with their desire for equality. For slaves, the independence of the United States was a step toward their own freedom, and they willingly fought to share a portion of that liberty. Not all enslaved African Americans, however, rallied to the cause of the Revolution. Some turned to whichever side promised the most expeditious route to their personal freedom. Great Britain, long a major transporter of human cargo, had no desire to free the slaves in America or its other colonies. However, several British leaders and their loyalist American allies saw distinct advantages in trading freedom to slaves in exchange for their military service in that it added to their fighting numbers while depriving the rebels of potential soldiers, sailors, and behind-the-line support. While the Americans were still debating whether to allow black enlistments, the British took action early in the war to entice slaves to gain their freedom by taking up arms against their former owners. On November 7, 1775, John Murray, the Earl of Dunmore, and the Governor of Colonial Virginia issued a proclamation. "I do hereby declare all indentured servants, Negroes or others, appertaining to the rebels, free, that are able and willing to bear arms, they joining His Majesty's troops as soon as may be, for the more speedily reducing this colony to proper dignity." More than 300 escaped slaves joined the British during the first month following the proclamation. Dunmore named his force the Ethiopian Regiment and issued uniforms inscribed with the slogan, "Liberty to Slaves." During the next few months, more than 30,000 slaves of all ages, both male and female, crossed the lines seeking the freedom denied them by their American owners. Over the next 7 years, 100,000 black Americans sought refuge and liberty with the British. Most of these escaped slaves worked as rear area laborers, cooks, and servants, but as many as 1,000 served directly as soldiers with Lord Dunmore and in other regiments. German Hessians, mercenaries hired by the British to help quell the rebellion, also placed black men in support roles and accepted some into their ranks as replacements for soldiers lost to wounds or disease. Although the degree of acceptance by white field officers of African Americans in their combat ranks and in supporting positions varied during the long conflict, no battle of significance took place on land or sea during the Revolutionary War in which black soldiers did not participate, at times on both sides. Official reports and available historical documents show that black military men played a role in the final victory. Despite their sacrifices, only a few slaves gained their freedom through military service. Following the war, the quality of life barely improved for black freemen and not at all for those who remained in bondage. The causes and campaigns of the Revolutionary War were many and complicated. The results are much easier to summarize. White Americans fought for the right to govern themselves. Black Americans fought for freedom for themselves as individuals and as members of their race.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.